this is out at Mount Sinai. I was investigating the marble remains of a building, okay? So I was trying to determine from the foundation of it, which was about all that was left, other than some scattered parts of columns, what shape it was. And I came across an inscription in archaic Hebrew. Now, this is back before the 8th century B.C., prior to that, 7th and 8th. And it stated that this was a shrine dedicated to the mountain of God, or the God of that mountain, by Solomon. I covered it back up because I was sure the Saudis wouldn't welcome that any more than they did the inscription on the pillar down by the beach that said that that's where God divided the sea for his people to come across, basically.
Okay, I suppose there's another question up there.
Yeah. My mind can't grasp the difficulties that the Israeli people, Jews generally, face with the release of this establishment of the Ark.
Yeah. Well, it is a real problem, and that is the people I have talked to in high places believe that when the people of Israel know that the Ark has been found, that they will go in mass down to the Temple Mount and destroy the mosque and build a temple to put the Ark of the Covenant in. And of course, mosque is the third most sacred site in Islam. Well, that would make the Muslims declare a holy war and start killing everybody, and they want to avoid that. So that is the problem. Now, just the other day, somebody said they had saw where the Jews were going to attempt to put this cornerstone of the third temple down at the base of the Wailing Wall again. Has been tried twice before. The last time they ended up killing 24 Arabs who were throwing rocks down on the heads of the Jewish worshippers at the base of the Wailing Wall. So I hadn't heard anything about it myself, but it kind of surprises me that they would do that. That's not part of the plan I'm familiar with. Okay, any other questions? Yes. Sitting on the Egyptian side, there are two Hebrew characters that indicate, actually they're hieroglyphics, and of course all of the early writing was basically a hieroglyph or a picture writing, but you had to know, be familiar with things that were in use and alive, you know, and that people bumped into frequently. But it indicated where the pillar had been set up, and that there was another one on the other side. Yeah. Got pictures of that somewhere. And it's still out there. And this last May, I took some people down and showed it to them. Yeah.
I know that God will be intervening, but it seems to me that there will already be something being generated over there with regard to this, because there's enough information being released to filter back to Israel, and therefore something must be going on over there to get things moving. You know?
Well, okay, what he's saying there is that one would expect that enough information was being made available or filtered out or whatever to these people that they would begin to think it had been found. What is actually happening, we have Grant Jeffries, who is saying the Ark of the Covenant is in Ethiopia. We have another group, can't think of the guy's name. Anyway, he said they found it in a cave over on Mount Nebo. We have a rabbi that says he saw it under the Temple Mount. And then we have this. So what they are basically measure it when you were over there with us?
No, I didn't. Actually, I was planning to go about now, but I had to be careful. I've got 100 feet of measure and 70 lengths to try and re-measure it. We measured four times by four people, but no.
Well, see, we measured it twice, and not one solitary measurement that's given in those books is accurate. Not one. One of the things just that you can spot right off is they say that the sarcophagus that's up in the king's chamber, that it's just the right size for the Ark of the Covenant to slide snugly in place inside it. The Ark of the Covenant is just over 4 feet long. We had a man who was 6'3" lay down straight out in it and took a picture of this. Of course, they have to rely on us to get the fact that he's 6'3". So we should have laid a measuring thing out by him. But none of the measurements are right, but I'm sure that you remember Richard?
Yeah.
All right. He was convinced by this, and when I told him that I had measured it and there wasn't one measurement right, he said, look, you know, I can't believe that. You must have messed up. I said, I knew we were going to take a tour over there. I said, get you a measuring tape, a long one, and check it for yourself. So when we got over there, he did. And my wife went with him and three or four other guys. They lunch shopmen. They went all in there, spent something like about 4 hours, came out absolutely drenched sweat because it's hot in that thing. And he walked up to me and he said, you're right. He said, there's not one measurement that is like they say it is. And there's no inscription in the ascending shaft. He says, there's nothing. And that's right. There's not. Now, Cheops apparently built it. It does appear that he was in the Hyksos dynasty. And this is the one, Djoser was a member of that. And we do know that Joseph built the step pyramid or supervised the building of it. There's some reasonably strong evidence that he supervised the building of three others, for a total of four, but there's no evidence that he did that. But I imagine, you know, they used the same techniques or whatever in doing that. I guess he kind of launched a competition as to who can build the biggest pyramid. And Cheops won. Thanks, Dennis. All right, let's see. I saw another hand. Yes, sir.
I don't know if you could elaborate on it at the moment. But last night you mentioned that Jesus had spoken to you. If you don't wish to talk about it.
Oh, okay. Well, we have just about time to share that. Any other questions? I'll save that to the last. Okay.
Just briefly, Ron.
All right.
Someone suggested some of the pyramids too, with the chambers focusing, going on an upgrade into the heavens to being an older infirmary way back in ancient times. And the shafts going down. Do you have any comment on that at all?
There are some
One other question after you answer this one is some of the parts of the earth, there's different pyramids and they have like sun worship rites and so on. What is the connection or how does that relate to the pyramids of Joseph?
Alright, the pyramid that Joseph built is facing north. All of the others are facing east, indicating that they were sun worshippers. As to whether these were observatories, the Egyptians did have a knowledge of the solar system. And at least one of the shafts in the Great Pyramid does point towards the Dog Star. To my knowledge, there's no magnifying lenses in these shafts or anything, but see him? On the video I'm talking about. Okay. Basically, it just came up to where there was a block there, and something had slipped about an inch and a half, so they couldn't get the crawler past it, but there was a metal latch that was designed to latch when it was dropped in place. So anyway, there's some more things about the Great Pyramid that I'm personally familiar with, but I'm avoiding doing anything about it because I don't want a distraction from God's work. So I'm in the throes of trying to figure out if the credibility from the discovery would help in presenting this other stuff or if it would simply distract from showing it. So if you all want to pray about that, the Lord will help me make the right decision. I haven't been able to come to a real convincing conclusion, so I've just left it rest until this point in time. But there's an undisturbed royal burial in there, and I know where it is. And I can give you scientific proof right now, but I don't choose to do that. And I know there's a lot of people say things like that, and they're lying, so you have no reason to believe that, okay? Anyway, let's get off of that. Once again, it's not a salvation issue. And I think that we need to be focused totally on saving the souls, including our own, at this point in time. And we should be extremely hard to distract from this, because God will take care of the rest of the things that are going on. All right, the story. Yeah, Dennis, one more.
Sorry, just one more. Just occurred to me that maybe this National Sunday that we're talking about, that is, needs to be released before you release these things, could be generated in Europe, possibly. I just wanted your reaction to that. It seems to me that's the more likely place that's influencing Jerusalem, the sort of the seat of Catholic power and all the different 10 countries that are signified by Daniel and Revelation and so on. But I just wonder if it came about with the new European government structure that there was some sort of move towards Sunday law, whether you accept that as being, you know, the National Sunday law.
Yeah. Well, as I understand it, the National Sunday law, or the mark of the beast, is to be enforced by the image of the beast, if I understand that right. And having looked at the issue fairly carefully, I think that probably the UN may well be the image to the beast. See, the beast power was a religious power who used civil authority to enforce its dogma on the world, that the part of the world it controlled. So if the UN used a civil authority, uses its power to enforce religious dogma on the world, it would be an image to the beast in some sense of the word. You might want to look into that, but just, you know, having looked at it briefly, the image to the beast was created and given life by the two-horned beast, which is America in prophecy. And John, you may want to have a look at that idea. You know, you may have already looked at it and thrown it in the dustbin. I don't know. Wait, the latter?
Sorry.
Oh, that's fine. Don't hurt my feelings. We're out for truth, not saving somebody's opinions. Everybody's got opinions. Okay, now can I tell you my favorite experience?